introduce Professor Mike Sharples from Open University of the United Kingdom. And first of all, I would like to say that on behalf of the organizing committee, we really thank you for your availability for being here today in Barcelona. Well, let's say close to Barcelona, more or less. Sometimes when people identify the city, they know that things can be done, maybe not exactly in the city center or in the downtown, but for sure you will enjoy the city too. Professor Sharples is professor of educational technology in the Institute of Educational Technology at the Open University in the United Kingdom. This university was probably the first university who used the term open to identify the availability to give people the opportunity to get into higher education without having any requirement for it. Here leads the Minerva project to transform the university process of course development, and also has a post as academic lead for the FutureLearn company. FutureLearn is one of the initiatives led by the Open University and other institutions in order to develop MOOCs in the English-speaking world too. His research involves human-centered design of new technologies and environments for learning, and he inaugurated the MLearn conference series and was founding president of the International Association for Mobile Learning. In addition, he is the associate editor-in-chief of the IEEE Transactions on Learning Technologies, a very reputed journal. She's author of over 300 papers in the areas of educational technology, science education, human-centered design of personal technologies, artificial intelligence, and cognitive science. So you can see that he's a person who has a long trajectory, a long path on the use of technology for educational purposes and in the idea of opening the scenarios and taking advantage and creating new opportunities for teaching and learning with the use of technology. He's going to give us a speech under the title of Innovating Pedagogy, Transforming Teaching, Learning and Assessment in Higher Education. One of the things that Professor Sharples is leading to is the publication of an annual, a yearly report on innovations in pedagogy at the Open University. It's a kind of report that it's a kind of pattern for most of us that in other institutions they are also following, because it's a good way to identify which would be the next trends in the very next future in the use of technology for educational purposes. Currently, we are in a situation in which it is said that we will need a lot of new students' positions at the universities. We will need to widen the access to everyone, because there will be a huge demand for higher education studies. Obviously, the most important challenge when facing this is how we will ensure the same quality, or how we will increase even this quality in order to train a new generation of digital people. It seems to be said that it can only be done by adopting innovative methods of course development, online delivery, and especially new pedagogies. So the discussion that Professor Sharples is suggesting us today is this one: how to deal with innovations, how to deal with technology in order to change pedagogies, and getting more people trained, appropriately trained, not decreasing the level of quality, and responding the demands of most of our students everywhere. So again, thank you very much for being here today, and I'm ready to give you the floor. place.
So thank you very much for those kind words. I'm very pleased to be back again in Barcelona. I've been here a couple of times before for conferences and also for holidays, because it's a beautiful place to visit always, and also the sunshine. So I'm not quite used to so much blue sky and sunshine, but I've got the rest of the day to enjoy it.
So, as the introduction said, I come from the Open University in the UK. It's the largest university in Europe, with 180,000 students. We're just coming up to our 50th anniversary, so it is also a long-standing institution for distance learning. When the university was founded, it was seen very much as a television university. It was called originally the University of the Air, teaching through television. And then the teaching methods changed to be delivery through video cassette, but always print had a place in our methods of teaching, and also tuition. So like Oxford and Cambridge, we have small group tutorials. We have 7,000 associate lecturers who provide small group tutoring to our students. So we have a mix of teaching methods. But increasingly now, as with many universities, we have been developing online learning. And I'll just give you one example of the big change that we've gone through. So for our science courses, 20, 25 years ago, we had home experiment kits. And we sent to students who were studying science, we sent them big boxes through the post of rocks, for example, for geology. We sent fish tanks through the post for them to put fish into it and to study animal behavior. We sent lasers through the post for them to make holograms. Nowadays, almost all of that science is done online. Not because we want to make life easier for ourselves and to stop sending things through the post, but because science is done online. For example, we have a very strong space science research group at the Open University, and we teach a number of courses around astronomy and space science. And our students get access to a remote telescope, which is based in Mallorca. And so the students are able to book time on that telescope, to be able to control it, to position it, to take images, all done remotely, because that's the way science is done now. We have access to remote labs as well, where students can control real equipment, but remotely over the web. So more and more of our teaching is done online. Field trips, because we have to be open to everyone, we have to make, for instance, our geology field trips accessible to all. And one of the ways we do that is by having people go on actual field trips and then webcast to those people who are unable to go on the field trips because they're homebound or disabled. And we have virtual field trips where you can go out into the UK Lake District and take rock samples and look at them under a virtual microscope. So you can look at real data, but online. So we are exploring and pioneering new ways of teaching and learning online. We're pleased to say that we've been the best UK university for student satisfaction every year since 2005, and we're very much a research active university. We do research not only in areas such as space science or geology, but also fundamentally research into teaching and learning. So teaching and learning is changing. And here are just a few of the drivers for change. Firstly, there's a need worldwide to provide 100 million university places for young people in emerging economies desperate for higher education. And this is going to double by 2025. So there is a huge need for access to education. You need to open a university every 2 weeks Sir John Daniel, the former Vice-Chancellor of the Open University, said every 2 weeks you need to open a major university just to cope with the growing demand for higher education. And of course, worldwide, we just can't build that number of physical universities. So we need to look for other methods. So the demand for education will continue to rise. We cannot afford to scale up at the current per student cost in any sector, in any country. But also, it's not teaching the same way as before. Our sectors should consider working more closely with employers to develop and promote all graduates with the wherewithal and confidence to be digital entrepreneurs. So the idea of being a digital entrepreneur is not just for some small sector of the population. Everybody now needs to have the skills to be creative with technology, to take a design stance in relation to technology. And that's something very new. And the new global market in education at a distance will greatly shift the educational powers. So I have a lot of links at the moment with China. In a week's time, I'm going to be giving a talk in Beijing, in Qingdao, in Shanghai. Shanghai in particular is a city of entrepreneurs. Apart from Silicon Valley, it's probably the place on earth where there are more entrepreneurs. There were some statistics last year of investment in education, and the top five investors in education came from China. So we shouldn't just see education now as being something from Europe and from the US. Education is global, and there will be global education providers. And of course, I can't give this talk without mentioning Brexit. And I went to bed, as many people did, listening to the news that, wow, it was going to be close, but all of the polls showed that Britain was likely to stay in the EU. And I woke up in the morning at 7 o'clock to hear that Britain had changed. It had changed completely. And you know, it came as a personal shock to me, and I realised immediately that it was going to have an effect on education on universities. Most of my research income comes from European grants, and without access to that, it's going to be a very different and a much more impoverished world of research. Many of our students come from overseas, but more than that, one of the consequences of the vote has been that it's divided Britain. It's divided Scotland and Northern Ireland, which voted to remain, from England. It divided London and the big southern metropolitan city from the north, and particularly it divided young and old. So my two daughters live in London, and they just couldn't understand what had happened in the country. One of them was very angry, saying, the old people, the baby boomers, they had it good, and now they've dumped it all on us. And my younger daughter, she was guilty. She said, why didn't we do more? Why didn't we do more to help? So, why didn't we do more to change the vote? So, there are big changes going on, and there are big changes that are going to affect everybody, not just in the UK, but across Europe, and in particular, the next generation. It's not only negative in that sense. We also need to prepare for the future. And if you go to the website Careers 2030, here are a few of the jobs that they're indicating will be needed for a career in the year 2030. So, an organic voltaics engineer, a furniture refurbishing technician, a recyclable design specialist, a marketing e-media maker, a big data wrangler, an agroecologist, a robot counselor, or a purchase prediction analyst. Now, how many of you know or have any sense as to what those jobs might be? We do have big data wranglers at the Open University, but we certainly don't train for any of the other skills and professions at the moment. So the world is changing, and I do recommend that you have a look at that Careers 2030 website, just to get an understanding of the way in which young people are going to need to be trained and continually retrained into the future. And also, there is a disruption in education. Much of it a positive disruption. A pattern is emerging throughout all sectors of a major shift towards online models of delivery, tending to disrupt traditional incumbents and traditional ways of doing business. So it mentions patterns and models, but what pattern? What models? In 2004, there was a series of major reports called the Horizon Report, and they're still being published. And they were, and it's, again, I recommend you to have a look at those. They're all available online, and they're now available in a number of sectors, including higher education. And they look at innovations from a technology perspective. And that's very interesting, valid, and worthwhile. But one of the problems with technology is that it changes very rapidly, and it's not always clear what the relationship is between technology and learning. For example, if you look at the 2004 Horizon Report, one of the technologies they identified as being ones that are going to be important for education in the future is scalable vector graphics. Now, I don't know what scalable vector graphics is, and I'm not convinced that scalable vector graphics is and was important for education. So I think it's important to have a look at this report, but it gives one perspective, a perspective from technology, which was the reason why nearly 5 years ago now, we decided we at the Open University, we wanted to try and produce something similar to the Horizon Report, but from a pedagogy perspective, from the perspective of innovation in teaching, learning, and assessment. And we thought a long time about what we would call it, about how we're going to identify innovations in pedagogy. And then in the end, we decided to do something simple and call it the Innovating Pedagogy Report. At that time, we really weren't sure whether we should use the P word, pedagogy, because it just wasn't in currency at that time. And I hope if we've done nothing else, we've been able to promote pedagogy as an important concept, as a word to be discussed alongside technology for learning. And our definition of pedagogy is quite simple. It's the theory and practice of teaching, learning, and assessment. And our annual report explores new forms of teaching, learning, and assessment for a digital world to guide teachers and policymakers in productive innovation. And the way we produce it is very simple. We get together a group of people at the Open University, and in fact last year we got together a similar group at SRI International in Stanford to have a transatlantic perspective, and we produce a very long list of possible innovations based on what we've read, what we know, people we've talked to, and then we rate them as to which ones we think are going to be really important over the next few years. And then we write an abstract, we write a summary for each one, and then the report. There isn't any big Delphi process or any big survey. We just do it. And so far, it's been pretty successful. The most recent one, these are some of the innovations we identified in the last one. And I'm not going to go through all of them, but it's just worth pointing out a couple of them that I'm not going to cover later. There's a major theme around connecting learning, and particularly valuing learning in context. So seeing context as something that is not just given. So when we are here in this room, the context is pretty fixed. I'm standing here, I'm using familiar technology, to present to you. But when you go outside, when you're out on a field trip, as students do, or when you're talking in the cafeteria or in the student common room, you need to create that context out of the people who are available and the other resources. You need to create that context out of the physical and the social resources. And how you create that context for learning is really important. And how that learning then can be brought back into the classroom is also important. So we had a study a few years ago called Personal Inquiry. And that was about developing inquiry-based learning for science. It was a study with schools, but it could equally be with higher education. And the idea was to start inquiry topics in the classroom. For example, is my diet healthy? And then for the students to continue that outside, at home, for instance, keeping food diaries, and then to bring back the results into the classroom. So you've got a cycle between classroom learning, informal learning, and back into the classroom. It was successful, but it really needed new forms of teaching. Particularly the role of the teacher changes in this from being a didactic purveyor of knowledge to being an integrator, being able to take variety of different data and resources, some provided by the students, and integrate them to do productive improvisation in the classroom. And for teachers to be able to do that, it requires a very different sort of training and professional development. Another one, just to mention, one of what we try to do in each report is to give at least one that's a bit more far out, a bit more provocative. And one of the ones in there is stealth assessment. And a lot of people have asked, what's stealth assessment? So the answer to that is it's what you do if you play computer games. So anybody who plays an online computer game is continually being assessed. That's how you know what your score is, whether you should go up a level and so on. And it's all done in the background. You're not given, when you play a computer game, you're not given a test or an examination. It all happens in the background. So the question is, can you do that in other educational environments? Can you allow the learners to focus on, for instance, an educational game or a simulation or interaction with other people where the assessment is done in the background? That's the basis behind stealth assessment. And like many innovations in education, there are ethical issues as well about whether assessment should be done in the background or whether it should be more visible. So many of these innovations also require thinking about from an ethical perspective as well as from an educational perspective. The other bit of data I want to draw upon is some work that we've done at the Open University around e-pedagogy. So for the last 3 years, we've been documenting and analysing the changing study patterns and practices of Open University students as they employ, adapt and integrate new devices, particularly mobile devices such as e-book readers and tablets, into their learning. And we have survey results from approximately 500 Open University students each year since 2013. So I'm going to bring in some of the data from those studies. But let me just put it into a broader context first of changing education. And we can really see it in sort of three phases. The first phase is about how do you enhance existing education? How do you take what we do already in universities and make it better? And some of the terms there you'll almost certainly be familiar with: MOOCs, massive open online courses, flipped classroom, open educational resources, mobile learning. The second phase is about new education. What can we do that's different? And I'm going to concentrate and focus a bit on that in my talk. And the third one is about sustainable education. It's not enough just to do things differently. We need to do it differently at scale if we want to meet the worldwide demand, and sustainably. It's not enough to have one-off projects that are then abandoned. We need to have sustainable innovation in education. So let me take you through some of these. I'll start with mobile learning. So, as I mentioned, we've surveyed our Open University students, both postgraduates and undergraduates, for 3 years now, from 2013 to 4 years, sorry, 2013 to 2016. And as you might expect, there have been changes in ownership. So the ownership of tablets have gone up, of smartphones have gone up. Interestingly, the ownership of e-readers and the use of e-readers have gone down. And it may be that e-readers such as Kindle and so on have passed their time, and that people are now using tablets for reading documents rather than e-readers. One of the things that we've found is that social sciences students tend to use e-readers more. Science students and business students tend to use tablets. And overall, there's a trend towards using smartphones as smartphones get larger and larger, and there are more and more resources available on smartphones. But I think what's more interesting is how they've been using them for their university activities. And I'm going to get my glasses now so that I can read that small writing. So this is showing the changes from 2013 to 2014 and then 2016. And the percentage of those with access to devices. So for those who have access to the devices, what have they been using them for? Well, there's been a trend on that top line up there. Where are we? There. For use of tablet computers for reading materials going up. There's been a similar trend for using tablet computers for preparing assignments, and pretty flat for using tablet computers for accessing forums. With smartphones, there's been an increase in the use of smartphones for accessing forums and then a decrease. It's not entirely clear why that is, and it's a large number of people we surveyed, so I don't think it's just some statistical artifact. I think it probably is the fact that people are swapping over from smartphones to tablets. They're taking their tablets with them more outside. And what's remained consistently low is using smartphones for preparing assignments. And one of the things that we've been looking at the Open University is what sorts of devices should we support for what sorts of purposes. And it's clear there isn't just one device, that there are different devices have different affordances. If you want to prepare an assignment, you almost certainly need a device with a good keyboard with a large screen. If you just want to browse forums, or if you want to read material, you may well have a portable device that you can take with you that's going to be accessible always. One of the big discussions we are having at the moment at the Open University is, should we do away with print? Should we have a digital-only courses? Because many of our courses still use print materials, and it's completely divided the academic staff. Some academic staff say, of course we've got to do away with print so that we can have more interactive teaching, so that we can have interactive simulations, so that learners not just absorb the materials but interact with them. Others say the only way to be scholarly is to be able to engage with print material, to be able to annotate it, to be able to compare documents side by side, to be able to make notes on your documents, and you can't do that if you're just looking at a screen. It's completely divided our academic staff as to whether we should go to digital only. It may be a non-issue in 5 years' time. We may have devices there which allow annotation, note-taking, comparing side-by-side. E-readers may be so cheap that you can spread out four or five of them beside each other to compare different documents. But until then, it's very much an open question as to whether you should keep print materials. Another thing we looked at was changes in study habits. So along the bottom is the number of different devices that people use. So the number of locations that people use for handheld devices between 1 and 7. And for those students who just use mobile devices in one location, there is very little change in study habits. So the orange is, have your study habits changed? For those students who just use a mobile device, a handheld device in one location, their study habits haven't really changed. The more they use them in multiple locations, the more their study habits are changing. And we really need to look further at that. I know there have been some other studies looking at whether people are using mobile devices sequentially or simultaneously. And it seems that people are starting to use mobile devices simultaneously, maybe having a larger screen and a mobile phone, and that they are taking them to more locations. And the more locations they have, the more their habits change. So we really don't understand yet in any depth how those study habits are changing as people use mobile devices across locations. And just to finish with that, here's one report from the, we also asked us, we had interviews with our students, and here's one of the results of interviews. I'm now able to study a lot more while on the move, commuting to and from work by public transport. This is because I'm able to download my reading materials on the handheld device, and this saves on carrying books with me to and from work. I'm also able to conduct research on the move by accessing websites and other reading materials. The laptop is now mainly used to complete final drafts of my assignments. So here you have a very resourceful and strategic student who is using their devices in a way that suits their contextual needs, suits the context and they're in and the task that they're trying to perform. And what we need to do is to try and move all our students towards that resourceful and contextual use of mobile technology. And in particular, we need to look at how you can connect that active learning outside the classroom, which may be exploration, it may be doing personal research, talking with other people, towards meaning making, towards trying to understand that activity, and then bring that back into the classroom for reflection, for synthesis, and then for further inquiry and how you can get. It's one of the many promotive cycles in education, in learning, that we want to try and achieve. That promotive cycle between active learning outside the classroom and reflective learning inside the classroom. Now I want to say a little bit about changing education with MOOCs and social network learning. So as you know, there's been a huge growth in the number of massive open online courses from a starting point in early 2012 up to now over 4,000 courses that are available online for free. There have been around 35 million course enrollments worldwide across all of the platforms. Coursera is still the largest with 19 million learners, edX with 5 million, and FutureLearn now is coming in third with 3.8 million learners. At the moment, 75% of the courses are in English, and there is a huge need to develop courses in other language. There is, as you would know, a Spanish platform, MyriadX, and a French one, FUN, but there is a need for further platforms and further courses. I'm pleased to say at the Open University, we're just about to present our first beginning Spanish course on the FutureLearn platform. So something about FutureLearn. FutureLearn was formed by the Open University in 2013. And it was, again, a disruptive change for the Open University, because until then we'd been fairly complacent. We thought we knew it all about how to do open learning. We had our own Open Learn platform. And then MOOCs came along from Stanford, from MIT, and forming FutureLearn was very much a reaction to that. And to his credit, the Vice Chancellor of the Open University decided not to try and do it within the Open University. The Open University has many strengths, but moving fast is not one of them. So the Vice Chancellor decided to set up a separate company called FutureLearn. And that company now has 60 partner institutions from the UK, from Europe and worldwide. And it's now the third largest MOOC platform worldwide. But when we set up that platform, we had an opportunity to try and rethink what an online learning environment would be. You know about virtual learning environments such as Moodle. Those were mostly developed nearly 20 years ago now. And we also knew about Coursera and edX that were very much based on a lecture model. How can you do lecturing but at a distance? And how can you make that more personalized? We had an opportunity to rethink the design of an online environment from a pedagogy perspective. So the starting point is which pedagogies are effective, which methods of teaching and learning are effective. And here are some of them. That we know, for example, that making learning more visible is effective, allowing learners to set their own goals and then helping them to achieve it. John Hattie, his life's work was in creating a meta-study of meta-studies. So taking research meta-studies of what constitutes, what makes for effective learning, and then surveying all of those over 800 meta-studies. And what he found was the top methods of teaching and learning for effectiveness are ones to do with making learning visible, making the teaching visible to the learner and the learning visible to the teacher. So that was one principle. Another one around reputation and reward. So rewarding learners for success and celebrating success. Around collaborative learning, that we know that if people work together, if they share their perspective, share their understanding, it's more successful than working alone. We know that providing timely feedback on learning and on progress is effective for helping learners to be guided towards successful outcomes. We know that formative assessments, so assessment to support learning and helping people to achieve mastery, is successful. And we know that empowering educators, giving them good designs and good tools to design learning, is successful. So those were the starting points. But we didn't just want to adopt methods from previous platforms. We had to rethink them for massive scale. So if you were not just teaching 100 people, but you were teaching 10,000 or 100,000 people, how would you do it differently? And we know that some educational methods get worse with scale. So if you're doing sports coaching, then it may work for 2 or 3 people, or maybe 10. It doesn't work for 100 or 10,000. Some educational methods are pretty much impervious to scale. So what I'm doing now, it's being filmed. It could be put on the web, and 1,000 people could watch it and get pretty much the same experience. But which educational methods improve with scale? Which ones get better the more people who take part? So that was one of the things we looked at when we started to design the FutureLearn platform. And there's something called Metcalfe's Law. And Metcalfe's Law comes from the data sciences and also from economics. And it says that for some network systems, the value of a product or a service increases with the number of people using it. So the telephone system is an example of that. When you only had 2 telephones in the world, they weren't terribly useful. But the more people who had telephones, the more they were interconnected, and then the more they were interconnected across countries, the more useful they became, the more opportunities you had for interacting with other people. It became a challenge for the technology to manage those networks, but for the people, they became more and more effective the more people who were using it. But of course, education isn't just about exchanging data. Networks to enable learning need to support conversations that are new, timely, usable, understandable, appropriate, and trusted. In other words, we need to not just create data networks, but we need to create social networks for learning. So when we started to design this FutureLearn platform, we looked at what sort of framework could be used to support that sort of design where the more people who took part, the better the learning got. and we decided on a rather obscure framework that came from an educational technologist, one of the earliest educational technologists, Gordon Pask, and more recently from Diana Lorillard, of learning as conversation. I must confess we partly chose it because it wasn't an American theory of learning. It was a very British theory of learning and based on a very different approach of learning as cybernetics. I'm not going to go into all of the theory. There's a massive theory underlying learning as conversation. But basically, the idea is that all learning is a conversation. We converse with ourselves as we reflect on our own experience. We reflect on our own activity and try to make sense of it, as we use language to interpret our own actions. And we use conversation as we're working with other people, as we're solving problems collaboratively. And those conversations can be at the level of actions. They can be conversations about the things that we do. So if we're doing, say, an experiment in a lab class, it might be about which wires do we connect, about how do we take a reading, about is this reading accurate. And at the higher level, at the level of descriptions, it's about are we performing the right experiment? What's the purpose of this? What are we trying to achieve? What's our goal? So you have conversations at two different levels. And you need tools to be able to support those conversations and to be able to relate them to what it is you're doing. So that was the starting point. And also what's interesting about this theory of learning is that it's implementable. We showed it to the software designers, and it was the first theory of learning that we showed them that they really got. That they said, okay, we can do that, we can make those sorts of conversations, we can design it. And that's what they did. So here are some examples from the FutureLearn platform. So at the bottom level, about having conversations around action. Instead of sending learners off to forums where they talk about the course as a whole, what we did was have each piece of content associated with a conversation. So every bit of content had a conversation associated with it. Now that was a bit of a concern because we didn't really know whether people would want to talk about each individual bit of content. And we thought there might be 10 discussions, 20 discussions, 20 comments. And as you'll see in a minute, we were overwhelmed by the amount of conversation that went on for each bit of content. We designed conversations at that higher level. So all of the elements in FutureLearn are designed as kind of pedagogic Lego bricks that you put together into sequences. And one of those pedagogic elements is a discussion. They're called steps, a discussion step. So you can have higher level discussions about why, you can bring in your own experience, you could discuss big questions that are set by the course. We've more recently brought in study groups. So you can have not only large-scale discussions, but also small group discussions with up to 30 people. The one thing we haven't done, and I would really like to see on the platform, but I'm going to include it for completeness, is this here, of supporting learners to be able to personally reflect on their own learning. So there are some other platforms. There's one called Classroom Salon, which allows any learner to be able to take notes directly onto the content, to highlight it, to make notes, and then to share those with other people so that you are reflecting on the course material and then you can see what other people have done. And what comes up is a kind of heat map showing the activity from other learners. So you can look at a piece of teaching material and you can see at a glance where other people have focused, where they've made notes. And then you can then look in more detail at what those notes are. It's a really effective way of helping you to reflect on your learning content and sharing it with other people. So was this successful? Well, we built the platform and we started the courses. I'm just going to talk about one of those courses, which is understanding IELTS. So it's preparing for the IELTS exam, which is the English language exam, from the course is produced by the British Council. That course is the largest gathering of learners ever. There were 270,000 learners on the first run of that course, from 190 countries, and for many it was their first time for learning online. We had many people visiting the course from the Middle East, for example, from Syria, from Iraq, Iran, many from Russia, from Ukraine. 35% of those people contributed to discussions, a third of those people, and 25% of them accessed on mobile devices. So it's a very different sort of learning, and learning at scale. That's just one, it's the first video from the course, and I'm going to come to learning design in a minute, but the course is very carefully designed right from the beginning to start from learners' own experiences. And it's called Exams and Me, and it's getting learners to just discuss about what exams mean to them. And each of those bits of content is associated with a discussion. So the one down the side, it says, Tariq Kadir says, the first thing I want is Rob's accent. Rob is the presenter. And then the lead educator says, hi Tariq, you like Rob's accent? Yes, very British. Guys, I just created a group on Facebook for those looking for another learner to practice their English with. Join the meetup. So this was one learner then setting up resources for other people to come and contribute towards. Each of these pieces of content then has a discussion alongside it. And you may have seen there 57,029 comments. Just that one video had over 57,000 comments. So we were faced with a problem. We thought there may be 10, 20 comments. In this course, there were 57,000 on just one video. So we had the problem of how do you manage that scale of conversation? It was a present problem to have, but we had to face it. So what we did was to bring in techniques from social networking, from Facebook, from Twitter, techniques such as filtering, so that you can, those comments, you can not only see them in time order, but you can also filter them by most liked and also by following. So you can follow particular people and then you can just see the comments of those people that are following you or that you follow. So you can then go to people's profiles. Another decision we made was not to have anonymity, to make everything visible. It's part of making everything visible. So all the people on the platform use their real names, not pseudonyms, and they're encouraged to create profiles. So you can go to that person's profile, you can see which other courses they're taking, and you can follow them. We have moderation, because one of the things, again, we were concerned about is that people would then start flaming and trolling, doing all the bad things that you do on social networks. We've been pleasantly surprised that almost always that hasn't happened. My own theory is that the first cohort from FutureLearn was mostly Open University alumni, because that's where we tested it, and that they modelled good practice, and that good practice has continued. We've had very controversial courses on Muslims in Britain, on climate change, but what's tended to happen is that people have come up with controversial views and responses on the platform, but people have responded in constructive ways, saying, can you provide evidence? Or, well, that's your view, but here is an alternative view. And their views have tended to then be taken up into the discussion. So we do have moderating. There is a moderation firm. Most of the moderation has been around people who have been posting in other languages than English. And one of the difficulties is when you have multiple languages on the platform, then people get confused, and also we can't moderate it. We don't know what they're saying. So we're now trying to have multiple languages and multiple moderation. And lastly, roles, of giving people educator roles, lead educator roles. And one of the things we want to develop further on the platform is to have learners themselves to use reputation management to be able to recognize who are the most effective learners and then to promote and to give them extra status as facilitators and mentors. The next thing I want to mention is around the relationship between learning design and learning analytics. So one of the consequences of setting up the FutureLearn platform is that we have massive scale learning. We have until recently, when I was doing research, it was usually in classes of 30 children, and that was the scale of my research. Now I'm analysing data from 3.8 million people. It's a different scale of research, and there are huge opportunities to do very rapid experiments, because you can do A and B testing. You can give one platform experience to one group of learners, another to another group of learners, or you can have a course that's repeated 3 weeks later and with a different learning design. So there is a huge potential now, a potential for a virtuous circle where inquiry into the learning process feeds into learning design, which then motivates learning analytics, which motivate future inquiry, and thus the refinement of the design and the analytics. So you're seeing this cycle of learning analytics feeding into analysis of learning, feeding into learning design, feeding into learning activity. And if we can make that cycle, again, drive good design and good understanding, then we can rapidly iterate, we can rapidly improve the quality of our teaching and learning. That diagram that I'm showing up in the top right is, I said that Future Learn was organized around pedagogic steps. That shows each step throughout a course in terms of, in red, the number of people who enter that step, in blue above, the number of, in blue, the number of people who enter, and in red below it, the number of people who've left that step, so who've completed that step. And in yellow, the number of people who've held discussions. So you can see at a glance the tail off of people taking the course. And some courses tail off very quickly. We lose people very rapidly in the first week. Some are a much slower decline. So we're starting to have those very high level understanding, but also much more detailed understanding. And I'll give you an example. At the Open University, we explicitly design all of our courses. We have learning designers who work with all the course teams. And one aspect of learning design is to get the course teams to think about what mix of learning activity they're going to have. And we have some simple tools to do that. And one of them is to get them to think in terms of seven different types of learning. So assimilative learning, which is reading and watching, learning by finding information, learning by communicating, learning by producing, learning from experience, learning from interacting with other learners, and learning from assessment. And for each course, we do a mapping as to, in the course, what's the combination of those different types of learning. And there isn't a best combination. Some courses will need more assimilative learning, some will need more communicative, but we can do that for every course. Because we've done that mapping at the Open University, we can then start to ask questions like, what sort of course designs lead to successful outcomes? What sort of course designs lead to student satisfaction? So there have been a couple of recent papers that have been published by Bart Reantes and Lisette Tutnell that are doing just that, looking at the impact of learning design on student behavior, satisfaction, and performance. And this is what they did. So they took 151 courses, modules, from the Open University and looked at the learning design from each of those. And are they primarily assimilative or communicative? They studied the student learning, so how the students performed. And they looked at three measures: student satisfaction, student retention, and student success. So were the students happy with the course? Did the students last the course? Did they finish the course? So these were our normal degree courses now, degree modules. They weren't MOOC courses. So, but even on our degree courses, we have students who drop out. And thirdly, student success. How did they do in their exams? Just want you to think for a moment. What do you think will be the results of this? Do you think that courses that have assimilative learning with a lot of delivered material, videos and text, do you think those will be most successful for student satisfaction and student retention? Or ones that have a lot of communication or ones that have a lot of assessment. What do you think? Any suggestions? Okay, just think amongst yourself. So the answers, we now know the answers to that. So, the answers are, firstly, that learning design had a significant effect on student satisfaction and performance. Learning design matters. And what they found was that courses that had assimilative and interactive learning, there was higher satisfaction. Students liked content that was delivered to them. And they also liked having hands-on simulations, hands-on lab experiments. Student satisfaction correlated with assimilative and interactive learning. But student retention correlated with communicative learning. In other words, when students worked with each other, they were more likely to complete the course. And also that assimilative learning, so learning through delivered content, had negative correlation with student performance. In other words, the more content you delivered, the worse the performance. So there's a real issue here in terms of how do you design a course. If you want to design a course to keep students happy, you give them lots of videos and text. If you want to design courses where students will stay and learn, then you need to have more collaboration and more interaction. So it's a learning design matters, and it matters in ways that really affect things that are important to universities, like student retention, satisfaction, and performance. One of the things we're trying to do now is what's called predictive analytics. In predictive analytics, we are looking at the first few weeks of how students perform on a course and then trying to predict whether that student will fail or not, what their performance will be. And we're doing it by using a number of different methods, which I'm not going to go into, but some very sophisticated statistical methods, Bayesian statistical methods, rule induction methods. We've got a number of different methods, but what comes down to it is that we can create these sorts of dashboards. So at the top, we can look at the overall student performance going through the courses, and you see there when there are tutor-marked assignments in blue, those are the sort of big hurdles that the students have to get over. And down below is each individual student, and it's just a quite simple traffic light scheme in terms of green, amber, or red as to how that student is performing. But not only performing up till that point, but predicting how they will perform for the rest of the course. And because we've got, when they complete the course, we've got the real data, we can then keep on tuning that to get more and more accurate. And it's becoming very accurate now. We can accurately predict for many students after the first 2 weeks of a module whether they're going to succeed or fail. So the question then is, what do you do with it? What do you do with that information? Who do you tell it to? Do you tell it back to the educator? And if so, how? How do you provide that timely information? Do you tell it back to the student? Do you say you're going to fail? No, you don't say you're going to fail. You need to have a much more subtle approach to it. And one of the things we're doing is saying to the students, if you want to improve your learning, then this is what you might do next. This is the resource you might go to. Or if you want to study with at the same level as the most successful learners on your course, this is what you might do next. So we're looking at ways in which we can use that analytics not only to help design courses in general, but also to inform educators and then to inform students. So that's moving on to something that's called adaptive teaching, and it's very much now one of the areas of innovation, is trying to develop courses that will adapt to both individual learners and also groups of learners so that it will track the way in which people are learning and offer timely resources. I want to finish with a bigger picture. I've been talking about some of the work that we're doing on innovating pedagogy at the Open University, but for the last final part of the talk, I want to go to a kind of higher level and talk about sustainable education. What do we need to do in higher education if we want to sustain this innovation into the future? What are the trends in higher education? Well, one of the main trends is around hybrid learning. The idea of learners taking open MOOC courses linked to degree programmes. So it started with a consortium of universities from Australia, Europe, US and Canada that agreed to accredit, cross-accredit MOOC courses. Students on those MOOC courses could pay a fee to take an exam and get course credit. On FutureLearn, we've just developed the notion of programmes where you can have a series of MOOC courses that are put back to back with a capstone course at the end where that learning is synthesized and you can take an exam. You get the initial courses for free, but if you want to take the capstone course, then you have to pay for it and pay for the examination. So it's an opportunity for people on free courses to learn alongside people who are taking courses for credit. It's starting to have hybrids between free courses and paid for accredited courses. And one way to look on it is starting to create these larger structures. So you've got MOOC courses which offer either open learning or certificates or badges, and capstone. So you would see a progression along those MOOC courses to a capstone course. Each of those can be associated with credits, so that if you have four MOOC courses and a capstone course, it might be equivalent to 20 UK credits or 10 ECTS credits, which then build up to 20 credits per year if you've got each of those being 24 weeks. So a student might do 20 credits in a year, and a postgraduate certificate in 18 months, a postgraduate diploma in 3 years, or a master's in 4 years. So it's a way of starting to build up from individual modules or courses up into accredited programs. And they don't need to be offered from a single university. Now they can be offered across multiple universities. And the broader opportunity is for blended learning, where in the US, Department of Education, they produced a major meta-study of comparisons of online and face-to-face teaching in higher education. And what they found was that students in online learning conditions perform better than those receiving face-to-face instruction. It was a really important report because it was the first time that they showed conclusively that people studying online could perform at least as well as those studying in the classroom. And they also found that there was a bigger effect in studies that blended online and face-to-face, because you had the opportunity to learn in a classroom and then continue that learning outside in your own time online. And once you start blending, then there are other sorts of blending that you can do. So blended conditions often included additional learning items and instructional elements not received by students in the face-to-face. So you can blend campus and online. You can blend free and accredited. Connecting locations and settings, embracing multiple cultures and languages, combining new methods of teaching, learning, assessment. And there are some universities that are really starting to embrace that notion of blended learning, such as the University of Edinburgh, which is trying to convert all its masters towards blended learning, where you can learn on the campus or learn online or a combination. And looking again at the bigger picture, this, you may have seen this diagram before. It's come from the Stanford Life Center. It's a traditional learner's lifelong journey. And what's in orange is the formal learning that they do. And even between the ages of 5 and 25, it's still less than 20% of the learning is in a formal setting. Most of the learning that people do is in an informal setting. And certainly after higher education, almost all the learning we do is an informal setting. So one of the opportunities is to make that informal learning count, to blend in the formal and the informal learning. So this is what, in the future, that sort of learning journey might look like. You might have a person taking a number of MOOC courses, even while they're at school, in preparing for higher education. Then taking a series of pre-university MOOC courses, and then finishing off with an exam, which then qualifies them to go into a university course. When they're in university, they may take a selection of different modules, including some that are MOOC modules recommended by their lecturer, by their professor, some provided by the university, some provided by other universities. So you may well get partnerships between different universities. And then as they go on, seeing lifelong learning and alumni not as just students that you ask for money, but as lifelong opportunities for learning, where they will take a combination of open and paid for courses for professional development. So to finish, there's a new landscape for education of hybrid and blended courses, connecting informal and formal learning, connecting open and accredited courses, of student-centered curricula, of adaptive learning technologies, of learning analytics and learning design in a harmonious blend, of lifelong learning support, and of a global marketplace for education. And I want to finish with a quote from Clay Shirky, who is an education blogger and commentator, who I think puts it very well. "We already know what the college of the future will look like, because the non-traditional students are creating it now. It's a hybrid of online and in-person classes, centered on the student and not the institution, with credits accruing from multiple schools and adding up to a degree in alternating periods of attendance and absence." So I just want to suggest that's a vision for the future of higher education. Thank you.